Welcome back to Emulating Jack Young, where today I finally got round to recording this extra video that I promised back in episode 6 a week ago. I do apologise for the delay in this episode. I've been busy with work over the last week and I've not had the time to record Regen Rovers and record this as well, and I'll have to set a bit of time aside to record this, as it's going to be a long video, as we are going to look at every single player in the series in detail. 120 players. We'll look at their profile, look at their history, look to see what they've managed to win in their career and the clubs they've played for. They're all at the age of 30 now. I've holidayed 2 weeks more since episode 6, just so we've hit our 30th birthday. In fact, it's the 1st of July, which is indeed our birthday. Before I get started, if you can hit that like button, it'd be much appreciated. After this video, there will be a couple more episodes. I will holiday probably 3 seasons in the next video, and then after that, we'll just holiday until all the players have retired. So let's get started then. At the moment, you can see I've got it filtered by current ability, but we are going to go down in name order, alphabetical order, although it does start with Csaba the Weaver Takacs, Hungarian. I think it's just because he's got a nickname and that's why he's at the top of the list. But you can see he plays for Arsenal. He's got 108 caps for Hungary and 33 goals in his career. If you want to look at the biography, just pause the video and you can read this in a bit more detail. That's probably the best approach here. So if you want to look at things in more detail, pause the video. Of course, you can download the save file from episode 6 as well to look at the players in a bit more detail. And there will be a couple more save files in the next couple of videos. But you can see, started at Juventus, but eventually moved to Arsenal for 25 million, where he's been since 2018-19 season. So he's been here 10 years now, which is impressive, really. You can see the competitions he's won in recent years for Arsenal, lots of things they've managed to win. They've won the Champions League 3 times in the last 7 years, the Europa League as well, FA Cup. Don't think they've managed to win the league, though. But it's great that they finally managed to win the Champions League, I suppose. Moving on then to Anik Ahmed, our Real Madrid Swiss player. 101 caps for Switzerland. Hasn't managed to score for his country, but he's a quality player. Of course he's a quality player to get into the Real Madrid team. Here's his biography for those interested in reading that, see what he's managed to win in his time. So he started at Young Boys in Switzerland, moved to Juventus for £36 million before eventually moving to Real Madrid for £41.5 million. And he's been here for the last 4 seasons now. Scored very few goals in his career, but he is a right or left back and they traditionally don't score as many goals, do they? He's got a few assists though over his career and good average ratings as well. You can see he's won a lot of things with Real Madrid, as you would expect. They've won the league, they've won the Champions, I know they were runners up in the Champions League this year. Sorry, I don't know if they've actually won the Champions League on this save. No, they haven't. Barcelona dominated early on, they won the first 3. But since then we've had a variety of winners. Bayern Munich, Man United, Chelsea, Liverpool have managed to win it again. In fact, where's Arsenal? I thought, oh, I've already messed up, because Arsenal didn't actually win the Champions League. They were runners-up 3 times. So I've already messed up there. I thought it said winners, but no, runners-up. Sorry, Arsenal fans, you haven't managed to win the Champions League yet. I've disappointed you already. Next up is Gaoth Algar, West Brom player, 90 caps for Ireland, 13 goals as well. He's spent his entire career in England, mainly in the Premier League, apart from one season in the Championship with Crystal Palace, where he started. Moved to Spurs for £27 million, and in the last 3 years, he's moved to West Brom for £15.5 million. And, he's had a decent Premier League career, I guess. Not spectacular, but good average ratings for the central midfielder. He's won a few things in his time. You can see winners of the Europa League with West Brom. He was runners-up with Tottenham in 2024, but he has managed to win the Europa League, which is impressive. But I think that's the only first team competition he's won apart from the Championship with Crystal Palace. I guess not every player can go on and win millions of competitions in their time. Next up is, I don't know how to pronounce the first name, but I mean, it looks like Jacob, but it's probably wrong. Andre, a Romanian, 108 caps for Romania, 8 goals, plays for Monaco, where he's been for many, many years, although he did move around a bit early on in his career. Started at Steaua Bucuresti in Romania before moving to PSV, and then Benfica, and a big money move to Monaco for £49.5 million, where he spent the majority of his career, I guess, and he's won loads of things in his career with various teams. Probably can't see the Romanian competitions anywhere if we don't have that loaded, but you can see he won the league with PSV, won multiple things with Benfica, and he's won millions of competitions and runners-up competitions with Monaco, as you can see there. So a very successful career in regards to gold medals, I suppose. Next up is Charlie Appice, our guy from Haiti. 103 caps for Haiti and 21 goals for the PSG player. He has been a quality player on this save. You can see he's moved around a lot early on in his career, mainly on loan from Juventus, as you can see. Started in Ecuador, though. One of the players we actually had to find a team for at the start of the save, and I had to use the editor. I used a randomizer, and he moved to Ecuador, El Nacional, before quickly moving to Juventus for a low fee, really. But some big money moves later on. He moved to Real Madrid for 1 year, didn't break into the team, moved back to PSG. That is a really interesting transfer from him. Very good average ratings, as you can see, over the years. He's won multiple things with PSG, as you would expect. He's also managed to finish third in the Caribbean Cup and the runners-up in the Caribbean Cup with Haiti. He's won the league a few times with PSG, although Monaco have recently been a bit more successful in Ligue 1. Moving on to David Argon then, our central midfield, English central midfielder, 109 caps for England and 20, is that 20? My eyesight's going. 20 goals. And for Liverpool, he's had a very successful career after starting at Watford. He then moved for £41 million, a lot of money involved with these players, as we know. And at Liverpool, of course, they won the Champions League last year, which is very good for them. They also won the Super Cup and FIFA Club World Cup as well. I don't know if they've won the league. I don't think they have. He's been runners up in the Confederations Cup with England. Did they win the World Cup at some point? I kind of feel like they did. Ah, yes, there they did. 2022 World Cup. Spain won the most recent one, but a lot of our players will have won the World Cup with England, of course. Next up then is, I hope I don't miss anyone, by the way. Sorry if I do accidentally skip someone, but we've got Sam Austin next, our San Marino striker. 43 goals in 107 games for San Marino. That is impressive considering they used to never score goals, but he's managed to score 43 goals for them. That is really, really impressive. And they are currently 118th in the world, considering they started, 206th or something at the start of this save, and they're all the way up to 118th. That is incredibly impressive. I'm just curious to see. They managed to beat Moldova this year. They've beaten Liechtenstein 7-0. Sam Austin with a hat trick. Beat Kazakhstan and Luxembourg. Really, really impressive stuff from them. They beat Macedonia. They got a draw against Croatia. Beat Faroe Islands, Kazakhstan twice. Really, really impressive stuff from them. I guess it's because of the what's it called? European. It's called the European International League on here, and you have different divisions, and the teams, the nations are in amongst teams that they are at the same level at, so they are more likely to win, I guess. I don't know which division San Marino are in. Is there an easy way to look at this? I don't know. This is Division D. So they're in the bottom division, but they're in Group 1. And there's promotion and relegation. It's a really interesting competition. I actually really like the idea. So I'm looking forward to seeing how it works in real life when it gets started. We didn't have a look at his history. You can see he started at Steaua Bucharest as well. Moved to Shakhtar for 15 million, then moved to Tottenham for big money, and then on to Leverkusen for 40 million. They spent a lot of money in this save. I think they've done reasonably well. They haven't won a huge amount, though, by the looks of it. They've won the Bundesliga once in this save, but as you can see, Bayern Munich. No, they've won it twice, sorry, but Bayern Munich have generally dominated, as you would expect, I guess. And they've also won the Super Cup. The German Super Cup. He also won the EFL Cup with Spurs back in the day, which has been dominated by the big teams in recent years. Moving on to Danish Bacon then, our goalkeeper, Danish goalkeeper from Marseille. 103 caps for Denmark. He is the Schmeichel of this save, I guess. He started at Valencia, as you can see there. Finally managed to break into the first Valencia team before moving to Marseille for, well, a reasonable fee, 6.75 million. Very cheap, really. And he has managed to win the Coupe de France with Marseille, the runners-up in the Europa League as well. but he hasn't managed to win anything else in his time on this save, unfortunately. Next up, Luigi Balotelli, our Italian striker. 8 goals in 23 games for Italy. Hasn't really progressed internationally, a bit like the real Balotelli, I suppose. He sort of stumbled a bit, I guess. He started at Chelsea, went on loan to 3 different teams before going back to Chelsea and not breaking into the first team. I suppose that was his problem. He was a backup goalkeeper. He's finally become a number one goalkeeper at Villarreal. Don't know if he's won anything. No. So he didn't feature enough for Chelsea to actually win anything with them, apart from runners-up in the Community Shield. And he won the Premier Division Cup, which is the Youth Cup, Under-23's Cup. So he's won something, but it's at youth level. And he has actually won... Oh, that's really weird. European International League with... Oh, yeah. So he won the this thing that I was talking about with Italy. So he did play enough games with Italy to actually win this. You can see Scotland have done really, very well in this competition because we gave them a lot of players. A lot of you guys are from Scotland on this save. So they managed to finish second. England have finished second. But the big boys have dominated this competition, I guess. As you would expect, even without us giving them that many players. Next up is Namana Mabalana Banana, our Cameroonian, who finally decided to play for Cameroon. Remember, he had a little bit of a fling with Switzerland, which didn't go to plan, and went back to Cameroon. He's got 19 goals in 28 games for Cameroon since then. Plays for Fulham, started at Real Betis. He was always a bit part player. He did some seasons, he got first team football and was reasonably successful. But since moving to Fulham, he's certainly had a lot more game time, as you can see. He's been up and down between the Premier League and Championship. They've just been a yo-yo team, haven't they? He scored 19 goals in one season in the Championship, so well done to him. And he's not won anything. He's been relegated 3 times, as you can see there. But he's won the playoffs. He's won promotion again this season with Fulham from the Championship. So he's had an interesting career, to say the least. Thomas Barrow is next, our guy from Nicaragua. 56 caps for his nation and 2 goals. And he currently plays for Hertha Berlin, where he's been for a few years. He started FC Crotone, something like that, in Italia, before moving it to Inter for 14.5 million. Never really became a first team regular. Moved to Schalke for 8 million. Quite a few games for them, but once again, not really a first-team regular. Before moving to Hertha for £5.25 million, where he has played a few more games for his club. He has managed to win a couple of things in his time, but that was an Under-20s Cup. And the TIM Cup, is that the Italian Cup or the Italian League Cup equivalent? I don't really know the official name of the Italian Cups, so that might be the official cup. I don't know. Anyway, he managed to win that competition and he's been runners-up in a couple things with Schalke and Hertha as well since then. Okay, next up is Baked Benz, our American Arsenal player. 24 goals in 106 games for the US of A. He's a right midfielder or attacking midfielder. He started at New York City and had a decent time there. Good average ratings. Moved to AC Milan for £6.75 million and played very well before a very big money move to Arsenal. And has been a first team regular for Arsenal ever since. And he's won a few things. Of course, I've already pointed out they were actually runners up in the Champions League. So runners up 3 times in the Champions League, which is very, very unfortunate, really. Also runners up in the Europa League, which they did manage to win once, but there's been a real variety of winners in this competition, which is great to see. And the runners-up as well, lots of variety there, so that's nice. Runners-up in the FA Cup as well. Have they managed to win that competition since? No. They've been runners-up 3 times. They're just the runners-up team here. Arsenal fans will be thinking, just same old Arsenal, eh? I'm recording this the morning after their 5-1 loss against Bayern Munich, so this isn't a great thing to see straight away. But they have featured in a lot of finals, and they have won a few things, let's be fair. Okay, next up, Hayden Bowles, our Middlesbrough Scottish player. 118 caps for Scotland, 26 goals. He's been at Middlesbrough the last 3 seasons. Started at Brentford, moved to Cardiff for big money, moved to Arsenal for very big money. And there's a lot of competition at Arsenal, so some seasons he got a few games, and other seasons not so many. So he's decided to move to Middlesbrough for first team football and played lots of games. Not such a good average rating. Not too bad, but not the best. And he was runners-up in the FA Cup this year, runners-up in the International League of Scotland, of course, and Champions League. Did manage to win the Johnston's Paint Trophy. The under-23s, of course, take part in the Checkatrade Trophy, as it's called now. And most years it has been a Premier League under-23s team that have won it, which is the reason why a lot of people have been boycotting that competition, I think. They don't want to see these teams in it. But Doncaster Rovers have managed to win it, as has Portsmouth and Port Vale, Milton Keynes as well. But yeah, it's not great to see all those under-23s teams winning it. I suppose it's good for the development of those players, but it just doesn't feel quite right, does it? Anyway, moving on to El Buco, our Mexican, who had a really good start to his career. His current ability zoomed up, didn't it? Really early on. I don't know if he's retired from international. No, he hasn't retired from international duty. I'm just curious as to why he's only got 87 caps for Mexico. Started in Mexico, moved to Juventus for $14 million before moving to PSG for £93 million. Probably the most expensive defensive midfielder ever. And he's won a lot of things with PSG, as you would expect. He really is flying for them. But PSG are just so dominant on this, aren't they? And they spend so much money. We've seen it in every single emulating series. They just spend a hell of a lot of money to get to where they are. Ben Kearney is next, our English centre-back, right-back, central midfielder. Good versatile player. 118 caps for England and 2 goals. Plays for Chelsea. Started at Middlesbrough, but moved to Chelsea for £48 million. And has been a first-team regular for them ever since. And won multiple competitions with Chelsea. They have managed to win the league. Man City have dominated in recent years, though. Won the World Cup as well with Chelsea, FIFA Club World Cup, Super Cup, various things. I assume he won the World Cup as well, yep. He featured in that. So he's had a really, really good career. Alex Calabrese is next, an American, also playing for Chelsea, 111 caps for USA. They're sixth in the world, they're doing really well. I suppose they've got quite a few of our players as well. So we've given them some quality players. They've been as high as fourth in the world rankings. And you can see the top four players. We've got Christian Pulisic on there, but the other four are players that we created, and they've been sensational and helped them up to sixth in the world rankings. So they're doing really well. Alex Calabrese started at Portland Timbers, moved to Napoli on a free, went out on loan back to Napoli. Then they were sold for £32 million to Dortmund, where he finally managed to get some good first-team football under his belt. Didn't really get very good average ratings, but Chelsea decided to spend £83 million on him, and he's been pretty good for them ever since. He's, of course, won multiple things with Chelsea. He's also managed to win the Gold Cup with USA, Confederations Cup playoff. What's that? Is that third? Oh, Confederations Cup playoff. What is that? Is that to get through to the Confederations Cup? I don't know what that is. Dortmund, he managed to win the Bundesliga as well. So he's won a few things in his time. Next up, Sebastian Kasper, another American. 120 caps for USA and 66 goals. Sensational player. Started at New York City, moved to PSG. Didn't really break into the first team for enough games to warrant being a class player for them. Moved to Juventus, though, where he did get first-team football, and then moved to Arsenal, where he's played reasonably well in the Premier League, being runners-up in multiple things. Winning quite a few things with Juventus and PSG, though, earlier on in his career. Ben Chapman is next. Our guy from America, Samoa. 108 caps for his nation. They're 184th in the world. Not doing so well. But for AC Milan, he's been there the majority of his career and had a very, very good time. He's one of the top scorers in this series. 204 club league goals. That doesn't include cup goals as well. So he's actually scored more goals than that. Started in Brazil. Played for two different teams there before moving to AC Milan for £8.5 million, where he has been incredibly good. He's won competitions with AC Milan, the Tim Cup, as we call it. He's won Serie A. Juventus haven't dominated this as much as you would expect. AC Milan had a good period. Napoli, also, and Inter have actually won the most recent title, so well done to them. But he's had a great career, hasn't he, Ben Chapman? Santa Claus is next, 196 current ability, one of the best players on this save. 100 caps for Finland as well, who are 54th in the world rankings. They've got two of the best players. They've got Erik Sivenen, who of course has won multiple World Player of the Year awards, six in a row of course, despite not having the best current ability out of our players. He has been incredible, but we'll look at him in a bit more detail later. But Santa Claus, of course, is up there as well. It's actually got a better current ability. It's a shame Finland haven't actually managed to move higher in the rankings thanks to those players. They don't have the players around them to support them, I guess. He's had a cracking career, though, with Man City in particular. After starting at Basel, moved for reasonably big fee for a goalkeeper, I guess. But in regards to his current ability, it was an absolute steal, wasn't it? He's won so many things with Man City as well. Runners-up in a few competitions as well. But he's had a fantastic career as Santa Claus. Kagu Commons is next, who is our assist machine. 102 caps for Northern Ireland and 11 goals. But he is ridiculously good at creating goals, as we have seen over the series. He started in Croatia, of all players, places, before moving to Sunderland for $4.2 million, and then a season later moved to Chelsea for $37 million, where he spent the rest of his career. He's won loads of things with Chelsea, hasn't won anything with anyone else, but yeah, he has been an exceptional player as well. I mean, most of our players have been exceptional, haven't they? Next up is Daniel Carter III, our South Korean, who has 115 goals in 130 games. That is insane. He's actually transfer listed by request at the moment at Bayern Munich, because I suppose he's not got as many games under his belt this season as he would hope. He moved around quite a bit early on in his career before settling in Bayern Munich, but he's never been their first choice striker in a way. He started a reasonable number of games, but he's been off the bench a lot. He scores goals though, 20 goals this season in 18 starts and 13 sub appearances. He is a deadly player, so he probably wants to be a number one striker somewhere for the last few years of his career. He's won loads of things with Bayern Munich though, as you would expect, and just been generally amazing. Moving on to Didi then, our Scottish left back, 97 caps for Scotland. He plays for Man United. He's only been here for the last couple of years, actually. Started at Leeds, moved to Leicester for many, many years, and had a good time there before Man United decided to spend £36.5 million on him. And he's managed to win the EFL Cup twice since going there. He also won the FA Cup with Leicester, runners-up in the Europa League as well. So he's had a pretty good career, to be honest. Moving on then to Tommy D. Next, our Australian defensive midfielder, central midfielder, or attacking midfielder. Versatile in the middle, 126 caps for Australia. We've got quite a few players playing for Australia, of course, and they are actually 11th in the world rankings now, doing really well on this save. As you'd expect, because we've provided them with quite a few talented players here, as you can see. He's been at Dortmund for many years. He started in Spain at CD Numancia before moving to Valencia on a free, who sold him to Dortmund for £41 million. He's had a really good career in regards to average rating, as you can see there. He's managed to win not much, really, with Dortmund. He obviously went there after they managed to win the league, I think. Runners-up in the Champions League with Dortmund, and they've won the DFB Pokal, which is some sort of cup competition, I guess. But unfortunately, hasn't won a huge amount in his time, but still had a very good career. Fjord Defence is terrified then, our Faroe Islands striker. 45 goals for his country. It's pretty good, actually. They have been as high as 25th in the world rankings, but they have dropped off lately. Don't know if he's retired from international duty. Doesn't say anything. Plays for Dortmund. Started at Rosenborg in Norway. Moved to Man United. Went on loan a couple times. Didn't really break into the Man United team before moving to Dortmund for £53 million, where he's had a decent career. He's won a few things in his time with Man United in particular. Also managed to win Europa League when on loan at Leverkusen. And then runners-up in the Europa League with Man United as well. Next up is Sithole Dladla, our South African defensive midfielder. 100 caps for South Africa, who are 71st in the world rankings. They've been quite high at times. He plays for Monaco. He's only moved there in the last few years. He started at Anderlecht before moving to Benfica for £23.5 million and another big money move to Monaco, where he's managed to win Ligue 1 a couple times in his short time at the club. He's won multiple things with Benfica as well. They're usually dominant in Portugal, aren't they? I think this is the league. Although Sporting have managed to be dominant in the last 4 years. But as you can see, early on, Benfica were very successful. Porto's only won the league once on this save, which is strange to see. Josh Downard is next, a German player, 105 caps for Germany, 68 goals. That is incredibly impressive. They're fourth in the world rankings, and two of our German players are listed in the top players list, as you can see there. He is a sensational player, and I think this is the second highest transfer fee we've seen. It might be that I think it's the second highest, but you can see he spent his early career in Germany playing for Dynamo Dresden, Stuttgart, Leipzig, and then Dortmund before moving for £104 million to Man City, where he's having a fine old time. They have won the league multiple times in recent years. They have been completely dominant in quite a few competitions in recent years, to be honest. And early on, he did manage to win the Bundesliga with Stuttgart in 2018. So he had some early success as well. So he's been a very successful player over his time on this save. Brian Drew is next, our Georgian. 89 caps for Georgia, 14 goals. They're 130th in the world. They have been as high as 50th, but they certainly have dropped off in recent years. He has spent all of his time in Spain. He started at Sevilla, went on loan a couple of times before moving to Atletico Madrid for 13.25 million, but he couldn't break into the team. Moved back to Sevilla, obviously realised it was a bad mistake leaving. He's had a good time with Sevilla. They haven't really, well, they've, he's won, is this, I don't know what division that is, with CA Osasuna. And he's been runners up in this competition with Atletico Madrid. But that's it, I'm afraid, for Brian Drew. Next up is Tea Drinker, an Englishman, of course, 43 caps for England, 8 goals as well. He plays for West Brom, where he's been ever since 2018-19 season. Started at Bristol City, and now he's turned into this West Brom legend, where he's actually managed to win the Europa League this year. Well, last year, sorry. They did well to win that. Runners up in the FA Cup as well. He's had a decent time, I guess, on this save. Michael Duncan is next, a Scottish goalkeeper, 24 caps for Scotland. Surprised it's not more, to be honest. He has been at West Brom his entire career. So this guy has really emulated Jack Young. He spent his entire career at one club, become, I assume, a West Brom legend. If we just have a look, he's not actually a West Brom legend. He's only on. Wait, where is he? Garth Algar is on favoured personnel. Why isn't Michael Duncan? I might have misread. You might have spotted him there, and I might have missed him by accident. But he's been runners up a few times with West Brom. Of course, they won the Europa League. So he's had a decent time with West Brom. And it's nice to see a player just being a one club man, isn't it? It's wanted by Man United, though. So he might actually stop being a one club man very soon. Boris Dundakov is next, a Bulgarian with 94 caps for his country. He's been at Man United his whole career, apart from a couple of years out on loan, but we can't really count that. So he really is a one club man as well. And he's done very well. His average ratings are very good. He's, of course, won multiple things for Man United too early on in the save, dominated. Not so many in recent years. Did win the EFL Cup last year, but they haven't won as much lately. Andreas Egg, next, German with 32 caps for his country. Plays for Leipzig. He's actually been at Leipzig. He started at Leipzig and moved to Gladbach for £8 million. Then to Barcelona for £25 million. Didn't get into the team. Moved to PSG for £15.25 million before moving back to his boyhood club for £12.75 million. Such a interesting career. And you can see here he's won a few things around Europe, a few things with PSG, managed to win this competition, International League of Germany as well. Martin Flickshaug is next, a Norwegian who plays for Barcelona. He's got 93 caps for Norway. I don't think we've seen as many players retire from international duty early on in this save, actually. He started in Norway before moving to PSG for a very low fee, eventually ended up in Germany before moving to Barcelona 2 seasons ago for £60 million. Where he hasn't actually won anything yet. He had his most success with PSG, as you'd expect. Going down to Aidan Flood, then, an English striker, the only player to have, well, he's got the least international caps out of any of our players. He's only been capped by England once, I'm afraid. He's a quality player, though. I'd love him in my team. He's really, really good. It's just we've got so much quality in the English team, it's a bit difficult for him to break into, I guess. He started at Man City before going out on loan to Bournemouth, West Brom and West Ham. He could never break into the Man City team though, so he moved to Watford for £12.25 million, where he's had some success in the Premier League with them. He managed to win the Checkatrade Trophy of Man City under-23s. He's been runners-up a few times in various competitions as well. His England debut was actually 9 years ago, so when he was about 21. He played versus Spain, but he's not played since, which is a shame really for him. I'm up next, Golden FM. I, of course, play for the Cayman Islands, who are 174th in the world. They have been quite high at times. I am the key man, as you would expect. And I've had a decent career, 10 goals in 87 games for my country. I've been at Monaco my whole career, apart from going out on loan. So I am kind of a one-club man as well, really. You can't really count loan spells, because you have to develop early on in your career, don't you? And I've had a very good goal-scoring couple seasons recently, so I'm pretty proud of myself. I kind of have emulated Jack Young in a way, because I'm a striker who's played for one club. I've not managed to win much. I won the Super Cup of Tim, whatever that is, in the first season. Runners-up as well, but Monaco haven't really been that successful. I've been relegated twice when I was out on loan. It's a shame Roma haven't done much on this save. There's still time though, and I've decided to stay loyal to Roma, haven't I? Jonas Foldager is next, a Danish midfielder, plays for Real Madrid, 92 caps for Denmark, started in Denmark as well, before moving to Cardiff City and then Real Madrid. Cardiff made a lot of money from some of the players they decided to buy. Really good player at getting assists and very high average ratings as well, so he's had a fine old time in Spain in particular, as you can see. Hasn't managed to win the Champions League though, the runners-up this year. Declan Frew is next, a Scottish centre-back, 119 caps for Scotland. Started at Sheffield Wednesday before moving to Arsenal for £30 million, and he's been ever-present in the team since then, winning multiple things, runners-up in multiple, even more things as well. Mark Furlan is next, another Arsenal player. They've signed a lot of players on this save. They just haven't quite managed to turn Arsenal into the dominant force they should be. I think they're the richest team on the save as well, we've seen. Hell of a lot of money. And they've been spending huge amounts of wages trying to get glory. And they've not quite managed it, have they? 35 goals in 112 games for Australia as well. This guy has started in Australia, played for two different teams in Melbourne before moving to Basel on a free, then Sporting, and finally Arsenal, where he's done very well. Winning multiple silver medals and the odd gold one as well. Did very well with Sporting as well, because they've been pretty dominant in Portugal. Next up is Jeremy Gaines, a Dutch midfielder. 11 caps for Holland, 3 goals. He's not really become a first team regular for Holland. He's had an interesting career though. Started in League 2 of Portsmouth before working his way up. This is good to say. I like these stories. Although he's not exactly emulated Jack Young at staying at one club, this is a good alternative. He started in League 2, moved to League 1, Preston, got promoted with them to the Championship, moved to Middlesbrough in the Championship before getting promoted to the Premier League with Middlesbrough, and then move into Leicester City. So I like those sort of stories. It's, you know, the Jamie Vardy, Mikel Antonio sort of route, isn't it, going up the divisions all the way to the top. And yeah, really nice to see. He's not actually managed to win anything, unfortunately, because he's moved to Leicester after they'd won the FA Cup, I believe. But he did get a runners-up medal a couple of years ago in the Europa League. Ole Gaultilio is next, another Norwegian, 98 caps for Norway, who are 33rd in the world rankings. They do have a few decent players, and Martin Ødegaard's up there. He's got 100 caps for AC Milan now, and AC Milan for Norway, plays for AC Milan. And he's the same age as our players. It just shows how young he actually is, really. And I don't get why people are sort of already criticising him when he's so young. He burst onto the scene when he was 15, remember? So he's still got a lot of years development. I'm talking about real life now. I think he can be a quality player. Anyway, back to Ole Gaultinho, who's been at Barcelona since that second season. Started in Norway, went on loan to AC Milan and Everton. But he's had a great time with Barcelona, playing lots of games. He doesn't get many goals, gets quite a few assists though. And you can see he's won a lot of stuff with Barcelona in his time. Where are we then? Lee Gamble, our Fijian, who 140th in the world, he is their key player, and he's got a lot more caps on this one compared to previous saves. 116 caps for Fiji. Plays for Schalke, started in Mexico though, played in Mexico for four seasons before moving to Portugal, moving to Benfica for £4.5 million before a very big money move to Schalke for £34.5 million, where he's had a very decent time actually. He hasn't won anything with them, but he won plenty of stuff with Benfica. Daniel Gannon is next, an Irish striker. 94 goals in 115 games for Ireland. Really, really impressive. They've been as high as 11th in recent years, but they're currently 19th in the world rankings. He is their top player, but we've got three players in there that are key men for the Republic of Ireland. We've got, he's won a few things, as you can see, with Real Madrid, which is good to see. I just realised I forgot to add Sam Reynolds. I did add him to this shortlist, but for whatever reason it wasn't showing, so I've had to re-add him. We will see him later on. Once again, I do apologise for Sam. He did reply on episode 6, by the way, saying he'd wondered where his player was. So I do apologise to him. He obviously had an episode named after him, which is good. But we'll have a look at him in detail later on. Okay, Joshua Gourley is next. Italian PSG player, 115 caps for Italy. He's had a really good time with Italy, actually. 115 caps for Italy is no mean feat at all. Started at Stoke, moved to Man City for £71 million, and this is the biggest fee we've seen. £119 million move to PSG. That is insane. Insane money. He's had a fabulous time with PSG. Didn't actually win anything with Man City, which seems really strange considering he was there for 4 years. Surely they won something in that time. But there's a gap. So I guess he didn't. He did win the International League with Italy as well, which is good. Won the FA Cup with Stoke early on in his career. And has been really successful with PSG in recent years. And they did win the International League again. He's a cracking player. Sebastian Hanna is next. Our player from Panama, 96 caps for Panama, 104th in the world rankings. He's a good player. He's sort of gone under the radar a bit in this series, but he is quality. Let's just see. He's played for Burnley in the last season, but he started at Union de Santa Fe in Argentina and played for Real Madrid, moved to Ajax on loan and Sporting and Leverkusen, moved back to Real Madrid permanent, to play for the first team, but didn't really break into the team, moved to Hoffenheim and finally to Burnley, playing in the Premier League now. And he won a few things with Sporting whilst on loan there. He won a competition of Ajax, and he's also managed to win the Gold Cup playoff with Panama. Next up then, who is it? It is, where am I? Mohamed Hendy Jr., who I think is our most capped player still. 143 caps for Algeria and 28 goals. They're 34th in the world rankings, doing pretty well. They've been very high, actually. Let's look at that again. They've been as high as 8th, which is very impressive, so well done to them. He has spent his career in Croatia, then England, and now France in Monaco, who are doing very well on this save, of course. He's actually managed to win the Africa Cup of Nations 3 times. Is that twice or 3 times? Twice, I think. Let's see. I could have sworn that said 3 times. Let's just go back. Oh, third place, that's why. Third place in 2019. Then they won it twice in a row. He's won a few things for Monaco as well. Third place in the Confederations Cup and the Olympic Games of Algeria. They've had a good time, actually, on this save. Christian Holland is next, our English attacking midfielder or striker. 87 caps for England, 21 goals. Plays for Man City. Started at Port Vale, though, before moving to Man City. But he's been there ever since and has been first-team regular for them, where he's won multiple competitions, having a good career. Josh Holling is next, a Welsh PSG defensive midfielder or central midfielder. Started at Portsmouth in League 2 before moving to Aston Villa and then Dortmund for big money and then to PSG for very big money. And he's been first-team regular for them ever since. Won a few things, won the League 2 with Portsmouth, DFB Pokal with Dortmund, and multiple competitions with PSG. Adam Hudson, a Canadian, going to do a 42nd in the world rankings. They've done quite well because they've been as high as, you know, the 30s, 32nd in recent years. They've got three players, three players, Sean Watson, Bearded Traveller, and Adam Hudson, and they're all doing really well. Adam Hudson's at Chelsea, started at West Ham, moved to St Etienne, and then moved on to Chelsea for £24.5 million. Hasn't been in the first team as much as he would like, though, but he still managed to pick up competition winners' medals with Chelsea. Ivana Hump Trump is next, a Welsh defensive midfielder or central midfielder. He's got 74 caps for Wales. Let's see where they are in the world rankings, if it lets me. There we go, 29th. Pretty high up, actually. They've been as high as 23rd in recent years. Of course, they do have three very good players with Sam Williams, Josh Holling and Ivana Humptrump. He's played for Burnley for a number of years now, but started at Fulham before moving to Newcastle, then on to Liverpool. Didn't really work out for him there. But at Burnley, he's become a first-team regular in the midfield, and he's won the championship with them. And he's also been EFL Cup runners-up twice with Newcastle and Burnley. And next up is Joe Hurst-May, a Man City player, 55 caps for Scotland. He's been at Man City his whole career. Another Jack Young. There we go. Well done to Joe Hurst-May. He's never, I mean, in certain years, he has been in the first team for the majority of the games, but there have been seasons, start the series and towards the end here, where he's not been first choice. But, of course, he's won multiple things with Man City, as they've been very successful on this save. Our next player is our South Korean Jack Young. Jae Young Park, 154 caps for South Korea. I think, in fact, that is the highest number of caps out of any player. 46 goals for his country. He plays for Bayern Munich, where he's been for a number of years now. He started in Turkey, though, before moving to Hoffenheim, then on to Dortmund, and then finally to Bayern Munich for £48 million, where I'm sure he's won a number of, yes, he has won a number of competitions with them, as they're always dominant in Germany, aren't they? In fact, he didn't win anything with his previous clubs. He's won the East Asian Cup and the Asian Cup with South Korea as well. So he's had a very good career, and he's an incredibly well-rounded player, isn't he? Moving on to King Jiggy, a Danish player, 98 caps for his country and 60 goals. Denmark must have a decent team, actually. They're 57th in the world, is pretty low. They've been as high as 12th, but in recent years they have dropped off, despite the fact they've got a number of decent players that we have provided them with. He's a quality player, though, this guy, and he's obviously been good enough to get a transfer to Barcelona. Started in Denmark before moving to Juventus, went on loan a couple of times, but he's ended up in Barcelona for £62 million, and he's had a very good career there so far. Hopefully still many years to come for him. He's won a few things as well, runners-up in a couple of competitions with Juventus and Leverkusen as well. Next up, Daniel Jordan, an English centre-back playing for Arsenal. He's got 86 caps for England. Let's just have a look at England, actually. 12th in the world rankings. Look at all these top players. All of them are players that we've created. They're quite low, actually. They've been as high as first in recent years. I suppose that's when they won the World Cup. So Daniel Jordan, quality defender, been at Arsenal for a long, long time after a £23.5 million move from his initial club, Hull City. And we've seen this numerous times now. Arsenal, of course, runners-up in a lot of competitions, but they have won quite a few as well. Daniel Keyes is next, another Englishman, another English centre-back, 30 caps for England. He's a world-class centre-back with only 30 caps. It just shows the strength and depth that England have. Started at Barnsley in the Championship before moving to Southampton, and of course, if you go to Southampton, you're inevitably going to get purchased by Liverpool, aren't you, at some point? And £44 million he moved for, a massive, massive fee. But he's had a good time in Liverpool. He's won the Champions League, he's won the Club World Cup and a few other things as well. With Southampton, runners-up in the FA Cup and EFL Cup. Bit unlucky there for Southampton. Lucas Kennelly is next, our Estonian goalkeeper, 112 caps for his country. He started in Argentina before moving to Barcelona. Had a couple of good years in the B team, but could never really break into the first team. And ended up at Leicester, where he has become the number one goalkeeper there in the last few years. He did manage to win a few things with Barcelona, despite being second choice goalkeeper for them. Palmer Koo is next, our Malaysian. 10 goals in 117 games for Malaysia. They're joint 105th in the world. They've been as high as 70th, though. He's really their only notable player, but he has actually retired a year ago from international duty. We haven't seen that many players retire from international duty, but he's decided to focus on his club career after having an okay time with Derby. They didn't really put their faith in him though, so he moved to LA Galaxy before coming back to Europe to Hoffenheim and then moving on to Marseille for £51 million, where he scored quite a few goals. Unfortunately, all he has won is the Coupe de France with Marseille and hasn't had any success with any other clubs in his career. Joy Kiox is next. Luxembourgian, 112 caps for Luxembourg, who are joint 164th in the world. They've been as high as 123rd, but that's where they're expected to be considering their population size. He's a great player though. He's a goalkeeper for Spurs. Started in Austria, moved to Germany, ended up in Burnley before moving to Spurs for £17 million. He was the number one for a few, well, I guess he was number one for the first couple of years before, you know, not so many games in the preceding years. So he went on loan to Lyon a couple years ago and was their number one. Came back to Spurs this season and only played four games in all competitions. So he may have to move on to try and get some more club football. All he's managed to win in his career is the EFL Cup in 2025. Next up then is Joel Narbel. He's been a sensational player in this series. 109 caps for Switzerland, 49 goals. Switzerland 48th in the world rankings. They've dropped off lately. They've been as high as 9th, as you can see there, and they've got two cracking players that we've produced for them. And this guy has been really, really good. He started in Switzerland before moving to Benfica, probably won a few things there, before moving to PSG for £56 million. Was a regular in the team, but perhaps not as much as he would like, and decided after the last season where he didn't really play at all, he moved to Bayern Munich for £66 million. He put their trust in him, and he has been really good for them. As you can see, he's won multiple things with them already, won multiple things with PSG as well. He's had a good career filled with lots of medals and cups and everything, but there's still a lot that he can do, I think, especially at Bayern Munich. Next up is Nikola Knezevic. Sorry if I'm murdering the pronunciations of these names once again. He's got 88 caps for Serbia, who are 26th in the world rankings and doing pretty well, actually. Four goals as well for his country. Started in Serbia before moving to Sevilla. Went back on loan for that first season. But with Sevilla, he developed his football. Got lots of games under his belt before moving to PSG for £43 million. And he's done really, really well. Looking at those average ratings, as you can see there. Won multiple things with PSG. Hasn't won anything with anyone else, but it's having a really, really good time in France. Villian Cressin is next, our Brazilian striker. 14 caps and 7 goals for Brazil, who are 5th in the world rankings. They have been first for vast periods of time on this save. He's not a key man for them, as you can see. He's only got 14 caps, but he's a cracking player, especially for Schalke. It was a slow start to his career. Played quite a few games in Brazil, as you would expect, I suppose, in his early days, and playing very well up front. But then when he moved to PSG, he hardly played a game for many, many years. From 2018 to 2024, he hardly played any games. Schalke finally put their trust in him. £13 million it cost to get him. And he scored goals every year. He's been pretty prolific, I suppose. And he has, I mean, he did win a few things with PSG, despite being, well, certainly not being first choice, probably not even second choice up front for PSG. Jake Lynham is next, an Australian striker, 89 goals in 108 games for Australia. It must be a record. 11th in the world rankings, as we've seen before. Australia doing very well because of all the players they have. And he's had a mixed career, as you can see. Started in Austria, where he played lots of games and scored lots and lots of goals, as you can see, in those first 2 years, before moving on to PSG for very little money, £1.5 million. Didn't really break into the first team at all. Another player that PSG decided to buy and try and ruin. Some of their players, of course, they don't really ruin, but other players, they're not developed in the correct way. He did go out on loan a couple of times before finding his way to Liverpool for £20.5 million, where he's become a first team regular and won quite a few things, including the Champions League, of course. So Liverpool have done really well on this save. I don't think they've won as much as Arsenal in total, but they have won that Champions League, haven't they? Neville Longbottom Jr. is next, a Greek striker. He's got 20 goals in 65 games for Greece. He's really had a career that's he's been all over the place. He started with New York Red Bulls, where he was pretty good at scoring goals. Before moving to Juventus, he didn't really put their trust in him. He went on loan to Real Sociedad, Porto, and Malaga, and then to Porto again, before finally moving to Dynamo Kiev in Ukraine. And he scored a few goals, not as many as you'd probably expect. But Barcelona decided to buy him, and yet again, at a club where they just didn't play him. And now he's in Saudi Arabia, banging in the goals. Last season, 29 goals. This season so far, it's already started. He's got 6 in 16. So he's found a club which love him, and he's actually scoring goals. That's his only, under the competition's history, that's all there is. He's just not really been at the right club at the right time to win anything. Matthew McBeath is next, a Scottish defence midfielder or central midfielder or attacking midfielder. He's versatile. 107 caps for Scotland, 22 goals. Plays for Liverpool after leaving Hull for £33.5 million quite a few years ago now. And he's done all right, I suppose. He's, of course, been part of the Champions League winning team and Super Cup winning team. You know, he's won things with Liverpool, hasn't he? And he's been close to winning things with Scotland, who've done very well on this save. To Madeira, then, our Portuguese striker, trying to emulate the Championship manager legend, as well as Jack Young, of course. 16 goals in 52 games for Portugal, who are third in the world rankings, doing really well. They've got some cracking real-life players in Bernardo Silva and Renato Sanches as well. And we've added to that with To Madeira, who's probably not been as prolific as they would have liked. He's playing for Burnley after didn't really work out for him at Barcelona. Started in Portugal, had a decent time. Barcelona tried to put their faith in him, but it just didn't work. Had a good time out on loan at Lyon and finally moved to Burnley in the Premier League, where he's done reasonably well. A couple seasons ago, 17 goals in all competitions, but this year, only 4 goals. He was their second choice striker off the bench 33 times. Bizarre stuff. Hopefully, another club will put their faith in him and make him their number one striker, because that's what he deserves, To Madeira. Mahusiv is next, another Cameroonian player. Now, Banana looked like he was going to be the star for Cameroon, didn't he? But he messed around trying to play for Switzerland, and club career didn't really go to plan, even though he had the better youth career with Cameroon. Mahusiv is the one that's pushed on and become the better player, the more important player for them. I don't know if he might have retired by now. Yeah, he has. So he's retired from international football. In fact, Banana might have as well. I didn't really look. So he ended up with 62 goals in 84 games for Cameroon, playing for Bayern Munich, playing for a massive team. So he's focusing on that career, the career where he can make lots of money. Started in Poland before moving to Germany. He's played for Stuttgart, Leverkusen, and finally Bayern Munich, where he's having a really great time, winning competitions, scoring lots of goals. Managed to win a few things with Leverkusen as well. And he won the Africa Cup of Nations with Cameroon in 2019. Din Mama is next, a Swedish player. They're 8th in the world. They've got quite a few players as well, remember. So they've benefited, and they have been as high as first, thanks to the players we have provided them. They've got some quality players. And Din Mama has only got 45 caps, so it shows the strength and depth that Sweden have. He started playing his club career in Sweden, moved to Juventus, another player that moved to Juventus and was sent out on loan, had some successful times in England whilst out on loan, and finally moved permanently to West Brom for £3.4 million. His average ratings haven't been that great, but he has managed to win the Europa League with West Brom, of course. And I think that's it. Won the Italian Youth Club Invitational back in 2018. Dylan McDonough. Sorry, I think you told me the correct pronunciation and I've completely forgotten. I do apologise. 110 caps Republic of Ireland, not Northern Ireland. Yes, 110 caps for the Republic of Ireland. 19th in the world rankings. Doing really well. Having a great time with Middlesbrough. And he has emulated Jack Young as well, which is great to see, because he stayed at one club, apart from a spell on loan at Derby County. He's been with Middlesbrough his whole career, which is brilliant to see. And they've been in the Premier League the whole time. I tell a lie. They got relegated that year. So they were relegated once. But they're back in the Premier League. They've been runners-up in the FA Cup. He's been promoted from the Championship. That's all he's actually managed in his career at club level, but he's a good player. Next up is Twold Medin, who plays for Ethiopia, 81 caps for the team, 132nd in the world rankings. He's a well-rounded player, as you can see there, and he plays for PSG. Although he did start in Romania, played quite a few games for Poli Timișoara before moving to PSG for £1.4 million, but they sold him to Real Madrid for £16.25 million. That was a mistake because they decided to buy him back for £72 million, but he hasn't played. What a waste of money. Real Madrid were actually playing him. He was having a great time in Spain. Look at that. Did he want to leave Spain? Was he forced to leave Spain because it was a £72 million bid? Because what the hell are PSG doing with him? Nothing. Why? What a waste of a career. Oh, I feel sorry for this guy because he was actually playing really well for Real Madrid. He's a quality player, but he's not got into the PSG team. It might be because he's injured. Maybe he's been injury prone. No, this was his first bad injury for 4 years. Ah, that's harsh. Really harsh. Dr. Mister is next. 92 caps for Nigeria and 39 goals. They're 13th in the world. They always do pretty well on this. And he's actually wanted by Man City at the moment, but Bayern Munich currently have him. Started in Croatia, moved to Werder Bremen, then moved to Bayern Munich for £62 million, where he's having a lovely time in Munich and winning lots and lots of things. He's also, I think, runners up in the Africa Cup of Nations. They actually haven't managed to win it on this save, when they are generally the strongest African team these days, aren't they? So it's a bit of a shock that they haven't managed to win it. Going on to Stijn Nieboer, a Dutch player, 17 caps, 5 goals for Holland, who are 7th in the world rankings. They've done quite well. Their key player is Sander Tielemans, though, of course. And Stijn Nieboer has played. He started at Chelsea, went on loan to Brighton and Watford, didn't break into the Chelsea team before finally breaking into the team at Southampton when he moved there. And then Stoke spent £31.5 million on him. He scored goals, but he hasn't really got a very good average rating. He's won a few things though in his time. He's won the European Championship with Holland, who followed up Belgium's win. So he's managed to win international glory, which is always the highest level, really, isn't it? So he's done well to do that. He's also won the FA Cup and EFL Cup with Chelsea a couple times. Next up then is Zebu Nation, another American, 99 caps for USA. He's going to hit that 100 very soon. And he plays for Monaco, who he's been at for a number of years. He started at Seattle Sounders, impressed enough to get a deal to Monaco on a free. I guess his contract ran out, and he's won lots of things with Monaco. Also managed to win a couple things with Seattle when he was over in his homeland. Next up is Danila Nikolajenko, then another Swedish player, 83 caps for his country. Plays for Spurs, but he's spent time at Norwich originally, and then Stoke City. Big money move there, and then another big money move to Spurs. I don't know how well Spurs have done on this, actually. They've won the EFL Cup. He's been runners up in the European Championships against Belgium. So he's done okay. Probably would have preferred to won a bit more, but Spurs, I think, have done well on this save, but they haven't managed to win that much. Moving on then to Nodar, who plays for Namibia, 84 caps, 24 goals, 109th in the world rankings. Has he retired from international duty? He has indeed, so he's ended with 84 caps. He started at Leeds, and after a little bit of a slow start to his career, he started to bang in the goals in the Championship before moving to the Premier League. And you can see here, every year, apart from this season, he scored at least 10 goals, at least 12 goals in the Premier League, which is good. I don't know what went wrong from this year. He did get 10 goals in total. That's a bit of a shame. He's not won a single thing in his career, though. Leeds and Aston Villa had not won anything. So that's a bit of a shame for him, but he's still been a good player. Dixie Normus is next, another American, 127 caps for USA and 24 goals. And he's a world-class attacking midfielder, as you can see there, who's really made a difference to the international squad. He started at New York City, played there for a few years before moving to Mexico, but finally got a big money move to England for Spurs, £28.5 million. And like we've seen, Spurs haven't won a huge amount on this save. He's won a couple more things because he's been there longer. He's won the EFL Cup twice, runners up in the Europa League. He's won a few things with America, New York City as well. So he's had a good career. Franck O'Hara is next, a French legendary striker. He's described as 54 goals in 109 games for France, who are ninth in the world rankings. They have been as high as third. Don't think they've been higher than that. Yep, third in the world rankings. He is a key player for them. And he's also a key player for Man City, where he's been for many, many years. He started at Bordeaux, moved for £46 million to Man City, and his most prolific Premier League season was actually this season, a couple seasons ago. 26 in the league, 28 in all competitions. He's won multiple things with Man City, of course, because they've won the league a lot and the FA Cup. And did they win the Champions League? Can't remember. I think they've actually been runners up a few times as well, haven't they? They've been runners up twice. Yeah, they haven't managed to win it yet. Maybe one day for Man City, because they do have some quality players. Jack Old is next. The opposite of Jack Young, of course. 120 caps for Austria, who are 77th in the world. What's happened to them? They've really dropped off. He is their key player, as you would expect. 71 goals as well. That's a really, really impressive record at international level. Started in Germany, moved to Hamburg before moving to Chelsea. And I guess he's not quite first choice. He gets a. Well, actually, that's wrong. He is first choice because he gets a lot of games, as you can see here. Doesn't play every single Premier League game. And I think. I mean, where's he played for Chelsea? I don't know. I thought there was a little thing that would show somewhere where he's played. But anyway, he doesn't score a huge number of goals for Chelsea, but at international level, he scored a lot of goals. He's won lots of things with Chelsea, though, including the league and the Champions League. So he's had a fine old time there. Jamie Oleszynski is next, an Indian who's got 96 caps for his country. They're 79th in the world. They've really improved, actually. Is it mainly thanks to the two players we've provided them with, or has there been a revolution in Indian football? Because they're known for being all the way down, 150 odd in the world rankings, but they have been as high as 69th, which is very good for them. So football is improving in India, maybe thanks to these two players we've created. He started playing in Poland before moving to Germany, Hoffenheim, and then big money move to Leverkusen, where he's been for the last few years. And played very well for them and managed to win the Bundesliga in 2026. That's his only title so far. Where am I? Matthias Orchard is next, an Australian left back, 119 caps for his country. Started in Chile, moved to Mexico before £11.25 million move to Arsenal. And he's done okay. I don't think he's first choice. Look at all those runners up medals. Crazy. He's managed to win the Europa League with Arsenal, but they've just been second best in so many different things. Adam Pengele is next, a German, 86 caps for his country, 23 goals. He's been an important player for Germany. Started at Dynamo Dresden, but since then he's been at Bayern Munich, so he kind of has emulated Jack Young. I think Jack Young actually started at a different club, to be fair, on Regen Rovers, didn't they? And because I had to sign all these players on free transfers. So technically, this is more of a Jack Young-esque journey anyway. But you know what I mean. We wanted to see one club men, and I mean Adam Pengele's pretty much managed that, hasn't he? And he's won so much with Bayern Munich as well. So he's been a very successful player. Leon Pereira, our other Indian, 46 goals in 106 games for India. Plays for Real Madrid. Only moved there a couple of years ago. Started in Romania as well. Moved to Dortmund. Finally managed to break into the first team and have a really good time before being bought by Real Madrid for £59 million. This season didn't feature as much for whatever reason, so he might have to move on again to get first team football. Has managed to win La Liga though, and also runners up in the Champions League with Dortmund and Real Madrid. We're getting towards the bottom. We've still got a long way to go. Johan Persson is next, our player from Madagascar, 150th in the world. They've been as high as 89th, which is pretty good. 75 caps for his country. And he has retired from international duty, unfortunately. Oh, he's gone to China for the big money. I was hoping someone would do this. I mean, he was really a one club man into that until that point, because he was with Bayern Munich apart from going out on loan. And eventually he did become a first team regular for Bayern Munich, but he's moved to Guangzhou Evergrande for £21.5 million. So he's gone over there for, well, I don't know how much they're paying him. Let's have a look. 185 grand a week, which is a lot, but not as much as what Arsenal are paying at the moment, of course. He's won a few things in China. In fact, he won the Ping An Chinese Football Association Super League. They have dominated that competition, as you can see. But with Bayern Munich, he was very successful as well. Next up is Pung. Oh no, sorry, Sacha Petshi the Second, another Nigerian. 109 caps for his country. And he plays for Real Madrid. He started at PSV, moved to 25.5 million to Real Madrid, and he's had a successful time over there, winning league titles and Copa del Rey competitions and various things. Punkle Fluffen is next, and another Australian central midfielder, 24 goals for his country as well. And he's played for Man City for a few years, started at Palermo, moved to Juventus for £32 million before a very big move to Man City for £69 million. And of course, he's won quite a few things with Man City. He's also won, oh no, actually, runners up in the Asian Cup with Australia. Twice, in fact, which is a little bit unlucky. But still, with Man City, he's won multiple things, of course. Ragnarsson next. Jonmundur Ragnarsson, an Icelandic. 96 caps, 32 goals. They've done pretty well on this. 31st in the world rankings. They've got two of our players, of course. And he's playing in Germany, Leipzig. He's started in Sweden, moved to France, went on loan to Sporting, didn't break into the PSG team, so moved on to Man United after a couple loans to England. But he didn't really break into the Man United team either, so ended up at Leipzig for £11 million. And he's won a few things, despite the fact he was only a bit part player for some of these teams. So he's done well. Where are we next? Ryan Reed, who's without a club at the moment, the Scottish goalkeeper. He's the Scottish number one, 104 caps. But he's wanted by a few Italian teams. He's been the keeper for Benfica for a number of years after leaving Olympique Donetsk after 3 seasons there. And of course, won a lot of things with Benfica because they were dominant. But yeah, he's left and now looking for a new club. Remedinho, a Gibraltarian, 110 caps for Gibraltar, 10 goals. They are 199th in the world rankings. They're able to be in the FIFA world rankings these days. And he started at Young Boys, moved to Inter, then PSG, £82 million, but made a loss because he moved to Chelsea for £46 million, and he's done pretty well there in recent years. Won the league, won the FA Cup. Won quite a few things with PSG and the odd thing with Inter as well. So he's done pretty well. Sam Reynolds then, the player that we missed out, is back on the list. 134 caps for England, which must be a record. Let's just have a look. Most capped player. Where does it say that? It is Sam Reynolds. Rousey's the all-time top goal scorer, but Sam Reynolds is a legend, despite the fact we weren't following him for a number of years. He's had a brilliant career, and he's been at three clubs, but he has been a Man United legend for a number of years because he spent so much time there after a £26 million move from Watford. And he's won a lot of things, as you can see there, including the Champions League twice, I think. So he's done very, very well. Nuno Ribeiro is next, another Portuguese player. He's a centre back for Bayern Munich. He started at Sporting, moved to Cologne, then moved to Bayern Munich for £44.5 million, where he's won a lot of things, including the Champions League this year. So well done to Ribeiro, or however you pronounce your name. Julie Rodrigo, I think he's our only Spanish player. Might be wrong. 15th in the world rankings, Spain are, but they did win the World Cup. I wonder if he featured. He's playing for Everton. He started at Watford, went on loan a couple times to a couple teams, moved to Arsenal for £24 million before moving back to Watford on loan. Didn't really break into the Arsenal team, so moved to Southampton before moving to Everton, and that's where he is now. And you can see he did win the World Cup, so he's picked up a World Cup winner's medal, just like a few of our English players. So well done to Yuli Rodrigo. He's also won the FA Cup and EFL Cup in his time. Andy Ross is next, an English wing-back or central midfielder for Inter Milan. Started at Villa, moved to Man City, didn't break into the team, and they made a huge loss selling him to Inter Milan, where he's had a much more successful time. He's managed to win a few things with them as well. Did pick up a couple medals with Man City, all runners-up medals though, I think. But he is a World Cup winner. So that's the most important thing of all, really, isn't it? Maybe some of these players won the World Cup a bit too early on and just went off the rails a bit. Although, that's a bit harsh, because he has done well for Inter Milan. Jack Rosser is next. 44 caps for Wales. Playing for Watford now. He started at Norwich. Spent time at Man City unsuccessfully, like a few of our players. Went on loan to West Ham and Southampton, but has ended up at Watford, where he's managed to pick up a runners-up medal in the EFL Cup. He won the Chequered Trade Trophy many years ago with the Man City under-23s. Lorenzo Rossi then is next, another San Marino player, and he's got 21 goals for his country. They've been scoring goals, so he's done pretty well. Sevilla is where he started before moving to Dortmund and then on to Bayern Munich. Bayern Munich just buy all the Dortmund players, don't they? Just like real life. And he's managed to win the Champions League this year and a couple things for Dortmund as well. Up next is Robbie Rotten, our Icelandic goalkeeper with 118 caps for his country. Been at Arsenal for a long, long time now. He's their number one still and picking up all those runners-up medals. Great to see. Well, it'd be nice if he could actually win some of the Champions League. It would be nice for Arsenal to win the Champions League. I'm a West Ham fan. I'm not an Arsenal fan at all, but they've been so close, haven't they? They kind of deserve it. Rousey is next, our legendary striker from England. He's the top goal scorer for England ever. That is an incredible goals to game ratio. Plays for PSG, where he's been for a number of years after an £86 million move from Liverpool, who bought him for £43.5 million from Sunderland. He's achieved a lot with PSG. He's missed out on the Champions League with Liverpool because he left. But he did win the World Cup with England, and that's the biggest glory of all, of course. Anders Sandvik, Norwegian, 33rd in the world rankings. I think we've already looked at them, but he's only got 20 caps for Norway. So he can't be the number one goalkeeper. Started at San Lorenzo in Argentina before moving to Chelsea. Couldn't get into the first team. He has got into the first team at Sunderland. Unfortunately, they conceded a few more goals, so his average rating's not the best. And he's not won anything with Sunderland. He did win the Champions League with Chelsea. I suppose he was on the bench for that one. Danny Sell then is next, our English centre-back, world-class centre-back as well. We've got so much choice at the back. Burnley is where he started before moving to Southampton. And then on to Chelsea, where he's had a very good time. His average ratings are phenomenal, really. And he's won multiple things with Chelsea. Managed to win the FA Cup with Burnley as well back in the day. And the World Cup, of course. Scotland Serenity is next. 127 caps for Scotland. 76 goals. That must be a record. Let's see. Yep, all-time top goalscorer. And he's also the most capped player. He has been sensational for the country that his name comes from. He started at Hamilton and had a really good first season before moving to Chelsea and was phenomenal for many years for them before moving to Barcelona. Has had less game time there, but yeah, maybe it was a bit of a mistake living in Chelsea. Still picked up very good average ratings. Guess he wanted to have some Spanish sun later in his 20s. And he's not actually won anything with Barcelona since moving there, so maybe he'll come back to England at some point. Hugh Shate is next, another Swedish player. 76 goals for Sweden. I presume that is a record as well. Let's just have a quick look. Yes, it is indeed. Anders Svensson has got the most caps. But yeah, he's been a very successful player and been around a bit, hasn't he? Started in Sweden, moved to Liverpool for a very cheap fee. Moved to Barcelona for £66 million. Impressed there. So Man City bought him for £91 million. So he's probably won a few things all around the world. Barcelona haven't really won anything, have they? Because he didn't win anything with Barcelona then either. Very strange. Erik Sirenen then, probably the best player of the series, let's be honest. Because he's won multiple World Golden Balls, World Player of the Year awards, despite not being the best player on paper. Like, his attributes aren't the best compared to other players. His current ability is not the best, but he has used his every inch of his ability to produce some incredible performances. He's won multiple things with Man City, as you can see there. Moved for £58 million from Leicester. His average ratings are the reason why he's getting so many awards. You can see he is just an assist and a goal machine. That season, in 2026-27, 26 goals, 27 assists, 28 Man of the Match awards. That is truly ridiculous, and that is why he is winning all these awards. James Sleater is next, a Northern Irish striker, 68 goals. Is that a record? It is. It is a record, so well done to him. He is playing for Spurs, so probably hasn't won anything in recent years, but he's been at MK Dons, Cardiff City, Brentford, spent a lot of money on him when they were in the Premier League, and Liverpool spent money on him as well. He won the Champions League with Liverpool, and League One with MK Dons, and the Chicotree Trophy with MK Dons. So his first winner's medal after League One was the Champions League. Next up is Wolfgang Smed, who apparently is the key player for Sweden. 16 goals for his country. Plays for Man United, but initially played for West Brom before a £58 million move, and he's had an exceptional time there, especially in regards to average ratings. Won the EFL Cup twice in 2 years. FIFA World Cup, Champions League, etc. You know, he's won loads with Man United, hasn't he? Third place in the 2022 World Cup with Sweden as well. Okay, next up is Saint Man. Another player from Madagascar. They had two of our players, of course. He has retired from international duty after scoring 26 goals in 86 games. He's at Sevilla now. He started in Poland, moved to Sevilla for £3.6 million, and he's done pretty well. He's a clinical goal scorer. 27 goals this season is really, really good, but hasn't managed to win anything in his career thus far. Simon Stark, another Swedish player. He's had a really good time with Man United on this save. Started at Norwich, but look at that. Brilliant average ratings for Man United. He's won loads of stuff with Man United as well, and of course, done well with Sweden as well. Brad Stewart is next, another Australian. He's a striker, 45 goals for Australia. Started in France before moving to Schalke for £36 million. And have they won anything? No, runners-up. In the Super Cup, and he's also been runners-up in the Asian Cup twice with Australia, and third place at the Olympic Games. Ted Bear Charlie is next, our guy from Gabon, 92 caps for his country. They are actually really high in the, well, relatively high, 50th in the world rankings. It's not amazing, but they're doing all right. He's picked up lots of caps. Started at Ajax. Never really broke into that team, did he, apart from the last season? And that convinced Leverkusen to buy him for £22 million. And he'd have won a few things with Leverkusen, because they've done pretty well, haven't they? Won Bundesliga, and a few cup competitions as well. He also won something with Napoli when he was there on loan, I think. Moving on, then, to Kevin Tejeda, who has done very well on this save. 55 goals in 83 games for Argentina, which is no mean feat at all. Started in Argentina before moving to Sporting, then £50 million move to Leverkusen, £80 million move to Chelsea, and an £86 million move to PSG. Huge amounts of money being spent on him in his career, and he's won lots and lots of things with PSG, Chelsea, Leverkusen, Argentina. They've won a couple of things, youth competitions, and also this competition, the Copa America. They've managed to win twice on this save. Brazil won the other one. Okay, next up is the Jack Young, 27. 16 caps for France and 5 goals. Not really had the best international career. And he's sort of been wasted by Man United as well. He moved there from Lyon for £32.5 million. And there was only really one season that he actually played. So he needs to move on in his... He's 30. He has to be playing. He has managed to pick up some winners' medals there, though. At least he's managed to do that, despite not really playing much. Fred Tholuop is next, then our Norwegian goalkeeper. 72 caps for Norway, and he plays for Man United. He started at Basel, but moved to Man United on a free. And he's been second choice ever since. He's not really played a huge number of games in his career. I think he's played the least games out of anyone, if I recall correctly, which isn't great, but he's still managed to win plenty of competitions with Man United. over the years after being on the bench for all of these victories, probably in these cup competitions. We've then got Scott Thurston, an English midfielder, 95 caps for England, 23 goals. He's a versatile central midfielder, as you can see there. Plays for Arsenal, started at Everton, but moved for £57 million a few years ago. He actually had much better average ratings at Everton compared to Arsenal. I don't know if he's won much. Runners up in everything. Confederations Cup, runners up with England, but he was a World Cup winner, and that's the only thing he has ever won, which is quite remarkable, really, isn't it? Sander Tielemans, who romped, that's the correct word, romped to the top of the current ability charts early on in this series and has been sensational. And it has kind of emulated Jack Young in a way. He's got so many caps for Holland there, hasn't he? 59 goals as well. Because, getting back to the Jack Young emulation thing, he started at a club, Vitesse, and moved to Monaco. And he's been there ever since. So he's been incredibly loyal to Monaco. He's not even a legend of the club, which is just bizarre. He's only an icon at the moment, but I would have thought it'd be a legend soon, surely. He's won loads of things in Monaco over the years, runners up in a lot of competitions as well, but he's had a fantastic career. Moving on to Bearded Traveller, Canadian. He's got 102 caps and 21 goals for his country. He's played for Real Madrid for a long, long time after leaving Ecuador. He started in Ecuador, moved to AC Milan for 1.1 million, and then a season later, £40 million move. And he's done well, actually. Spent one season out on loan, won plenty of things with Real Madrid, which is good to see, and Gold Cup runners up with Canada as well. Next up is Nathan Turnock, a guy from the Cook Islands. He's reached 100 caps for the Cook Islands, 179th in the world. They've been as high as 160th in recent years. Defensive midfielder playing for Marseille, and he started in Cyprus of all places before moving to Sevilla, and then on to Marseille for £27.5 million, where he's been ever since. The only thing he's really achieved is a second place in the Europa League. He might have won the league in Cyprus, but we can't actually see that league in detail. Next up then is Osama Unana, the second from Andorra, who they're not bottom of the world rankings, but they're close to the bottom, and they've stayed close to the bottom the whole time. San Marino, of course, have improved massively over the years, but with Osama Unana the second, they haven't managed to progress at all, really. He's not helped them. I suppose it's just the position he plays in. It's not really going to have a huge amount of impact on a team. But at club level, he's had a great time. He started at Ludogorets in Bulgaria, then moved to Southampton, and then on to Napoli for £33.5 million, where he's spent the majority of his career. And he's won a few things in Italy. They did win the league a couple times, three times, in fact. I think he's picked up two league titles. So he's had a decent time in Italy. Cammy Unbelievable Jeff is next, then an Albanian player, 75th in the world rankings. They've been as high as 38th, though. They've done pretty well on this. And he plays for LA Galaxy of all teams, which is quite random, I guess, at this stage of his career. But I suppose now they've reached 30, they're thinking about retirement. Where do they want to play? And he's gone over to America. But he started in Inverness in Scotland, moved to Burnley for £1.5 million, spent a good few years at Burnley, had a good career, good average ratings in the Premier League, before moving to LA Galaxy for £37 million. I've never known an American team to spend that sort of money. I might be wrong. Maybe there has been a huge transfer out there for that amount of money, but I don't think so. That is crazy money for LA Galaxy to pay. And he's not won anything with them yet, but he did win the championship with Burnley and the runners up in the EFL Cup. And that's all he's managed in his career. Jan Willem van der Berg is a Dutch goalkeeper, 91 caps for Holland, emulating Van der Sar, I guess, there. And he's been at Liverpool for most of his career. Did start in Germany, but after £25 million move, he's been the Liverpool number one ever since. And of course, he's won the Champions League. He's won the Euros with Holland as well. He's had a very successful career. Almost at the bottom now. Quinlan Vos is next, a Slovenian who currently 49th in the world rankings. They've done pretty well. They've been as high as the mid 30s, I think, in the world. 103 caps for his country. He's wanted by Juventus at the moment. Started in Slovenia before moving to Real Madrid. but didn't break into the team. So moved to Lyon on loan, Sampdoria, Montpellier, Villarreal, and finally left Real Madrid for Marseille for £5.25 million. We've seen Marseille signing quite a few players, actually. And he did actually win the Coupe de France this year with them, runners-up in the Europa League. And he won the Supercopa de España in Real Madrid as well. Joe Wagner is next, another American, 95 caps for his country, 31 goals. Started at Celtic before moving to Atletico Madrid, didn't break into the team, but moved back to the UK, moved to England in Stoke, £14 million they paid for him. And he was a regular in the first team until the last couple of years, where it's been not so much. He's only won stuff with America, he's never won anything at club level. Simon Wakefield is next. 111 caps for England and 17 goals. He's an absolute star. I think he got an assist in the World Cup final for England. Started in France, though, Stade Rennais, before moving to Spurs for £27.5 million, and then on to Man City for £55 million, where he's won multiple things with them, and of course, that FA Cup. FA Cup? World Cup, that's what I'm trying to say. World Cup. As well, scored winning goal in final, actually comes up there, that's it, yeah, he scored the winning goal, so he's famous all around England for that goal. He's up there with Jeff Hurst now, isn't he, in that regard. Sean Watson is next, another Canadian with 104 caps and 87 goals for Canada. I presume that is their record. Yes, it is. Most cap player is actually Donnell Henry, the West Ham player. But if he's still playing, then he should beat it. But he's still playing for Canada. I reckon he'll beat that record. He started at Lazio, a couple spells out on loan, before moving to Liverpool for £37 million. And he's done really well, actually. Obviously, he's won multiple things. He wasn't in the Champions League winning team by the looks of it, but I think in real life he would have got a medal if he played any part in the Champions League journey for Liverpool. Danny Wesnesio is next, another Swedish player, 67 caps for Sweden. Started at Leeds United before moving to Arsenal, £35 million. He had a good start to his Arsenal career in terms of game time, but dropped off towards the end before moving to Napoli. And then Chelsea decided to spend a lot of money on him. His average rating's never been great over his career, but he's played for some big teams and he's got some good winners' medals in his loft now. Two more players to go. Sam Williams is next. Central midfielder for Wales, 89 caps, 15 goals. And for Man United, he's won a few things, but he's only been here for two seasons. He started at Bournemouth before moving to Leicester for £30 million. Barcelona spent big money on him, and he had a great time in Spain. And now he's moved to Man United for £63 million. He's a quality player. He never won anything with Barcelona, though. He won the FA Cup with Leicester twice, and he's won the EFL Cup twice with Man United. And lastly, it's Jack Young Ginger. Or Ginger Jack Young has 55 goals in 91 games for Scotland. That is a really good record. And he's played for some very big teams. He started at Crystal Palace, moved to Leicester for £61 million, and then on to Real Madrid. They actually made a loss. He went to Real Madrid for £54 million, had a good time there, lots of goals scored, and they actually sold him for a loss to Man United for £38 million, where he scored a fair number of goals in the last two seasons. He's won plenty of competitions with Real Madrid in his time, which is good to see. So that's it, guys. That's all the players. Hopefully I didn't miss anyone out. If I did, I really do apologise, and I'll try and show them at some other point or send you some screenshots if you're particularly interested. But that's the players for you. Next episode will be a proper episode. It'll be episode 7 of Emulating Jack Young. And we will holiday 3 years into the future. And then the final episode, we will holiday until all the players are retired. Please smash that like button to show your support for this series. I know it's a long video, but I had to do this at one point. I wanted to show all the players in detail so you could see their biography and see what they've won, etc. So thanks for watching, and I will see you very soon.